muslimfilmfestival.org. Proceeds benefit Muslim Film Festival. You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. Up next, About Health with Dr. Michael Lenore.
All right, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore. And today we're going to be talking about some of the things that I want to present to you around children. Our special guest is going to be Dr. Carl Robinson. Dr. Carl Robinson is a pediatrician, author of a book on infant health, and also a practitioner in New Orleans. Going to talk with him a bit about what's happening in New Orleans and how he's fared, what the health situation is like down there. But we're going to mostly spend as much time as we can trying to answer your questions about your children, your grandchildren, your nieces, nephews, you, or whoever, as it relates to children's health. We're going to talk about what happens during the summer, some aspects of parenting, some of his opinions on things, some of yours. As always, our number is 510-848-4425, 510-848-4425, and Rangita will give me the 800 number. I almost got it memorized, but I don't want to take that chance. But 510-848-4425 and the 510 area code. We're About Health with KPFA, KPFB, KFCF in Fresno. So we'll be getting Dr. Robinson on the phone. He's already there, but before we go directly to him, let's talk about the heat. Now, you know, it's pretty hot out there now. I know for when we talked to Dr. Robinson about comparing the heat here and comparing the heat in New Orleans, this is like wimpy little heat, but it's a heat wave for us. And so consequently, you know, you got to be careful out there. You know, we tend to take for granted sometimes that things are going to cool off in the Bay Area, and sometimes they don't. So we want to make sure you're using that sunscreen, regardless of how young your children are. And also make sure that you're well hydrated, especially if you're inside. Many people don't have air conditioners in this area and probably don't need them, but that means that the temperature in the house can be even hotter than the temperature outside. So pay attention, and if you've got loved ones who are kind of shut in, then you want to make sure that they are comfortable and that they're well hydrated and well taken care of. So while this is a little lightweight heat wave for us, I'm sure compared to New Orleans, then it is for us a time when many people do get dehydrated and when the sun always exerts a certain amount of damage. And so consequently, please be careful and take care. So Dr. Robinson, thank you for taking the time to join us from the New Orleans area. I know that these little heat waves we have here wouldn't even register down there, would they?
Yeah, it's 95 and about 90% humidity.
Oh, yeah, that's kind of average. I mean,
that's pretty average.
So the little lightweight 81, 82 we might have here.
Yeah, you're having a cool streak. Cool streak.
All right. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to join us. Dr. Robinson and I are old friends and colleagues from many years ago in San Francisco and remained friends throughout that time. And he has been through the whole scenario of the Katrina epidemic. And so tell us, things getting back to normal in New Orleans?
Well, it's going to take another 5 years before we talk about getting back to normal. As you know, we lost over half of the population, and people are slowly coming back. It's estimated that there are about 200,000 people back in the city.
And the city was originally?
Around twice that number.
Mm-hmm.
But they're slowly coming back. Many are not coming back, obviously, and so if we peak out at 300,000, we'll be very fortunate.
Now, how has that changed? What is the health situation like that? I know at one point you only had one or two emergency rooms open, and are the hospitals coming back, and what about emergency services now in New Orleans?
Well, emergency services are still abysmal. We have, I think, three emergency rooms fully staffed at this point. We have, we have Children's Hospital emergency room staff. We have Touro, and we have Tulane, which is in the city. All of these are in the city. We lost about four or five emergency rooms as well as hospitals.
And the hospitals completely closed?
Completely closed. In the eastern part of the city, there were hospitals there, which were relatively large, and both of them were underwater. And then in the surrounding communities in Chalmette, and out in that area, other hospitals were lost. And Memorial Hospital was lost in the city. Mercy Hospital was lost in the city. And there were two campuses that were, those were tenant hospitals that had severe water damage and will not be reopening, apparently.
So none of these hospitals are planning to reopen?
Well, the tenant people are selling their their hospitals that are in the city. They're up for sale at this point, and they are not reopening. The Methodist Hospital, and as well as the Chalmette Hospital and the St. Claude Hospital, I think were owned by the same people. And there's no activity out there at this point.
Now, you're a pediatrician. Tell me what it's been like for you. I mean, from the time this thing hit to resurrecting a private practice in the city of New Orleans.
It's been very interesting because, as an understatement, I guess, because we've had to rethink how we're going to market people and how we're going to get people back into, you know, into the practice itself. What has happened is that we lost, I would say, over 50% of the positions in this area, if not more. The ones that were in private practice that were in the eastern part of the city are not coming back. That was a significant number of positions. And the ones that were in some of the other surrounding parishes that are adjacent are not coming back. And as a pediatrician, we've had to, in fact, I think that there are probably less than, in the city itself, maybe four or five pediatricians.
In the whole city?
In the whole city practicing at this point.
And what was it like before?
We had over, I think about at least 100 pediatricians or more in the metropolitan area. I'm not sure exactly what was in the city, but the numbers are way down.
As it relates to health, you know, when we saw the epidemic we saw the impact of Katrina on poor minority communities, African American communities, has the resurrection of New Orleans from a health perspective, are we still seeing that disproportionate focus on those communities, or have they received maybe a bit of a boost simply because of what we recognized in the areas of poverty and what we recognized about those communities?
No, they have not received a boost in terms of the needs. What has happened is that the governor, for example, has now put together a redesign committee to relook at and redesign the health care that takes place in Orleans Parish as well as the adjacent parishes that were affected. But the people who are coming back, and especially in pediatric care, most of those kids were Medicaid, and there were limited numbers of those who had insurance. It's going to be more of a crisis if we continue to deliver health in the same fashion that we delivered it before.
Let me ask you a question that it's very seldom asked. You know, New Orleans, and having visited there many, many times, there was a feeling every time that I visited in the last few years that things were not perfect there and were deteriorating. Does this offer, I mean, clearly this would not be the solution or the way to deal with those issues as it relates to health and other issues that have social implications. Is this an opportunity to do some things right that weren't going right before? Obviously, that's difficult to see in view of the horrible tragedy, and this would not be the way. It's almost like Sodom and Gomorrah. It's always like some city's been completely wiped out. And do you see this as an opportunity to provide care for the patients that you're most concerned about in poor and disadvantaged areas that might not have been there had this not happened?
Absolutely. I think that this actually is an opportunity to redesign and relook at how healthcare is actually administered to those who need it the most. Well, we all need it as much as anybody else, but certainly those who are underserved and underinsured This is an opportunity from a national perspective to look at a region and attempt to remake the healthcare system in a way that it could be functional and serve the greatest number of people. In other words, everybody needs to start looking out of the box now. It's a different way of approaching the problem.
Now, when you say that this is a chance for redesign, describe what you consider the system before Katrina, and what would you like to see different about it now as it relates to the health care of children?
Well, the system before was a mixture of what we call the, quote, charity hospital, unquote, system, mixed in with the private sector, mixed in with you name it, and it was all fragmented. And many people were, there were many, especially with children, who did not have a medical home. And here's a great opportunity to provide each and everyone with a medical home if a system can be designed appropriately and sensitively to the both the healthcare providers as well as to the client itself.
We know that the needs of children, the healthcare needs of children, depend upon so many more things than just how healthcare is delivered.
Right.
We know that it's a social environment in which they find themselves. We know that it's a nutritional environment in which they are raised. We know that it has to do with violence as part of that whole social construct. Do you see these other systems changing sufficiently to support what might be a meaningful change in how healthcare is delivered to these children?
I think that done properly.
Did you just change the speakerphone? Because we can't hear you.
Yeah, I think that the opportunity is there. The problem is whether there will be enough initiative to really stand out and do it. And I'm not sure whether that's here or not.
We're talking with Dr. Carl Robinson. He's a pediatrician, a very distinguished pediatrician in the city of New Orleans. We're talking about what's happened as a result of Katrina. If you want to join us in this dialogue, later on we'll be talking about general pediatrics. So if you've got a question about your child or something that you want to contribute, or maybe some questions about the parallel in New Orleans and how we can better be prepared for similar catastrophes in our area. Our number in the 510 area code is 848-4425, 848-4425. And so I think I've got the 800 number. It's 908-5008. 908-5008. So if you want to join us, please don't hesitate to do so. And I think talking to Dr. Robbins is a special opportunity for all of us. When we talk about, we talked about the ways in which general delivery is taken. What about specialty care? What about care for children who are critically ill, chronically ill? How's that being handled?
Well, fortunately, Children's Hospital exists here. And Children's made an extra effort to maintain most of its practitioners, and was one of the few hospitals that really did over and above what needed to be done. And so most of the pediatric services, believe it or not, are being taken care of there. The specialty, every service is covered. And even the LSU system, pediatrics has now completely moved to the Children's Hospital campus. So that's pretty good. The Children's also provided the private practitioners space, those who wanted it, space to practice, which was really above and beyond, since most of them had lost their offices in the process during Katrina.
So that time seems to be completely different from what you meant. They kind of held in there, didn't they?
Yeah, they thought out of the box and did the right thing, I think. And it's unfortunate that most of the other hospitals have not done the right thing in terms of that. But we can't really speak for the adult hospitals, per se. But it certainly they did the right thing.
What about things like palliative care for children, or specialty care? I know that's the specialists left in the same proportion that the primary care doctors left.
Yeah, they did leave in the same proportion. The biggest problem that I keep running into is people to take care of for counseling and psychological services. As you know, a lot of those kids were in town during Katrina, and a lot of them had many, many problems as a result of being here. And then we had those who went to other places and now are returning and seeing those houses and homes that they grew up in all in ruins. And so it does make a difference. We've only opened a limited number of schools, and so a lot of their friends are not there, and counseling services are not back at all. Counseling services were poor before Katrina, and now counseling services are even worse. Psychological and counseling services are even worse right now.
One final question before we go on to take a couple phone calls about this and going to talk some more pediatrics, or child health care.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see parallels for what happened in New Orleans? You lived in San Francisco, so you know the area. You have kind of a unique perspective on that.
Mm-hmm.
What should we be doing? Clearly we're not trying to jinx our city, but we have had a major catastrophe here within certainly our lifetime. What do you think our city should be doing around this area to prepare for potential catastrophes that involve the health of children?
Well, I think that everybody's going to have to start rethinking and relooking at care for children, the emergency care for children, ways in which to provide triage, appropriate triage, and then to deal with the after effects of any disaster. It's interesting that the Army, the military seems to be the only one that can go out and deal with an emergency. And when it's over, the military does deal with its dependents in an appropriate fashion. And maybe we need to start looking at how they do it. And certainly some of the cities, especially in New Orleans and other areas that are prone for disasters, really need to look at that model and see what we can do on a private side in order to make it better.
All right, let's take a phone call from Marie Louise. You're on About Health. Hello?
Can you hear me okay?
We can.
All right. Well, first of all, to me, I very often feel like there needs to be a great distinction between health care and medical care, because I have survived through a lot of medical care, which has been extremely dangerous, and therefore health care and medical care to me are two not always at all compatible things. But so that's one thing I want to say. And then I feel like, well, we're going to have to understand that if we don't educate parents early on in how to safely take care of their children, we are not going to change much unless it happens early, you know. And so here's going to be a very radical suggestion. Instead of military so-called service, how about letting people serve as humans in child care? You know, have a stint at taking care of children. Then people can decide if they're compatible with children, if they think they can handle it, and they'll learn a lot. And they'll learn a lot from themselves as well as from the children they take care of, because children are good teachers in many ways, you know.
Now, I'm trying to understand exactly what your idea is.
My idea is that it needs to start from the beginning. But, you know, as long as, well, I'm sort of mixing up two ideas,
right?
Probably. But I do think that we are going to have to start so early so that the parents feel safe. And that would mean teaching the parents early, having parental helplines, having things that where parents can turn for help. Well, we don't have that very often, do we? If parents are in a difficult situation, those who don't have so-called health care or medical care, or who don't know very much about taking care of children, they don't have very many places to turn to.
You know, I think that's an interesting thing. Thank you very much, Marie. That's very interesting because Dr. Robinson, you wrote a book several years ago. The name of that book was...
Baby Care.
Yeah, on Baby Care. And uh-huh. you had a lot of information in that book about parenting. You know, you had a lot of information about the need for supporting parents and supporting them early on, even before they had children. Give us some of your thoughts on that in response to Marie Louise's question.
Well, I think she's right. And incidentally, I view medical care as a subset of health care. But I think she's right that we have to start with the parents. We have to start with the young teenagers, teaching them their roles as adults and their responsibility as adults, and that impregnation and all of those sorts of things should not be appropriate at when you can't take care of those children. And I think she's correct in that we need to begin to train them as adults, as young people, and the younger the better, for their roles that they need to take care of, that they need to assume as adults.
Do you think so often children who, you know, in teenagers suddenly find themselves with adult responsibilities, but nobody's really talked to them about that as part of the process? I mean, I think in the old days, I mean, I've always envisioned in talking to my parents and grandparents, and we had little rituals still in the South when I was growing up. But I think a circumcision in the bush at 14 nearly tells you you're an adult. But we don't really have that kind of transition for teenagers anymore, do we?
No.
And so what could parents, I mean, how could parents really do that? I mean, I know most parents try, but what ideas do you have for that?
Well, I think parents need to pull the kids in and start concentrating on their growth and development, on what outcomes will be present and prevalent. Everybody knows what everybody has in their own mind, what a good child is and a good adult is, but very seldom do we go through that process of eating together, speaking together, allowing discourse together, and then allowing having the child to participate in all of that. And so that's the first step, I think. I think the lady who called earlier was absolutely correct. It starts very young, and we make good adults by bringing the families together, the mother and the father, of those children to create a cohesive unit, and to attempt to at least provide that child with some models to design him or herself on.
All right, 848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code. 1-800-908-5008 is our 800 number. We're KPFA, KPFB, KFCF in Fresno. This is the About Health program. And let's go to Daniel in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Good afternoon, Dr. Lenore.
Good afternoon, Daniel.
Thank you for taking my call, and I've enjoyed listening to your guest, Dr. Robinson.
Thank you.
Now, what I'm about to say is going to be difficult to hear, but I believe it's very important. In fact, I know it is. And that is that people at all levels in this country, and specifically I'm going to narrow this down to the situation in New Orleans as an example, need to understand that, quote, Katrina was not, how shall I say, a natural disaster, a catastrophe in the sense of a natural disaster. It, in fact, and one does need to do research, and I will give a basic place for people to go, which is the National Security Archives, not to be confused with the National Security Agency. This is a private, not-for-profit government watchdog. And from their main website, one can then find references to all of this that go back, actually has its antecedents before World War II.
Well, we get it. We don't have time.
I realize that.
We haven't got time to go back that far.
Right. But individuals may online take the initiative. We need to understand that the problem is a problem that we do not, the people of this country, whatever their beliefs, whatever, we do not have really any meaningful control over the governmental entities that not only, and really this is the transnational, multinational corporations that dictate to the banks, the World Bank, etc., because Katrina was, in fact, and this can be proven by doing the research, a planned disaster, a model that was deliberately, with malice aforethought.
All right, let me ask, Daniel, thank you very much for that contribution. What about the conspiracy theories, Dr. Robinson? Are they still abounding in New Orleans that this was a conspiracy to dictate to the city as for, that it was disproportionately focused, it was deliberate, or was it just considered just a series of just a situation where there was so much, so many warnings and so little attention paid? Are the conspiracy theories still abounding?
Not as much as they were initially. Conspiracy theories are still there. As you know, the disaster came after Katrina had passed through. The levees broke, and that's where the city caught heck. From the levees breaking, the city would have probably survived very well right after the hurricane. The problem was that the hurricane devastated the levees, and the levees broke, and the city became inundated with water, and literally Lake New Orleans. There are some conspiracy theories there, but they've not been proven at all. I think that what we have to do is pass the conspiracy and move to try to make our city better and make our area better and try to let the rest of the country learn from this so that these situations will not exist again.
All right, what about the whole issue of diseases? I mean, there was all these forecasts that there's going to be cholera, there's going to be some subtropical diseases you hadn't seen in this country. There's going to be a lot of mold and allergy and asthma. What have you actually seen as a result of this horrible catastrophe?
Well, it's interesting that, again, the major problem that I've run into have been not necessarily medical problems in terms of mold and allergy. My asthma has not changed. In fact, it's gone down. The mold problem does not appear to be as much of a problem as it was. It may become more so in the wintertime. And a lot of that is because the trees are gone. Everything was blown away. So we don't see the trees and we don't see the pollen, as high a pollen count as we used to. But what we are seeing from a medical standpoint is the psychological impact on children and adults, on the adult side, we're seeing a lot of homeless people coming back who are just crowding up the emergency room, which is another problem that we have. Now we're beginning to see more people in clusters. They're in the same homes which have not been renovated, and so that's going to be a problem, I'm sure, as we approach cooler weather down here. These groups of people who are coming home in these rundown homes that exist.
All right, let's go. All right, thank you for that comment. Let's go to Octavius in Santa Cruz. You're on About Health. Octavius gone. All right, let's talk a little bit more about the pediatric piece. I mean, I think one of the things that your very fine book on infant health, I think, was designed, I think, for some relatively unsophisticated parents. And you know, what I find is that most of us as parents are relatively unsophisticated. Most of our knowledge about parenting comes from our parents or grandparents, and certainly that you can't knock that. There weren't books or DVDs or CDs for 10,000 years, or 15,000 now, or 5,000, however you want to believe the numbers. But tell us some of the things that you think are really important for children to, let's start with prenatal care, because I think your discussion on prenatal care is one of the finest pieces of that book. What is it that that we don't do for parents in our healthcare system that are pregnant?
Well, I think the early entry into the system is the important thing now. And the more we get these parents in there, these young parents into the system, will become more critical to us in terms of care. And I as we become more sensitive to having these young women with prenatal visits and talking about their pregnancies and talking to the appropriate physicians who are ready to take care of them, even the perinatologist, I think it becomes very important.
Yeah, one of the things that I've always been concerned about is we've had we have a prenatal program for mothers to come and talk to us before they deliver and, you know, ask their questions and get a connection. But, you know, it doesn't seem to be as popular as I thought it might be when I first started many years ago. Much of the time when we meet new parents is in the hospital after they've already had the baby. And I think that that's a real lost opportunity. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I agree. And I've always, you're right. The number of parents who used to come and see the doctor don't come anymore. They we usually just see them when they're born. And it's unfortunate because that's the time to come when the mother finds out she's pregnant, or certainly no later than the 6 month of pregnancy, she should have made contact with someone, and or if not several people, in order to see whether she likes them or not, and whether they are capable of caring for that baby.
You know, one of the things that that I think that's a good opportunity to do is because what happens with an obstetrician? You know, they go to the obstetrician, they sit there, he slaps the baby, he's gone. And here we are, therefore, I used to say for 25 years, I'm not as optimistic that I'm going to make 25 from this point on, but certainly we're there for a number of years, and I think interviewing a pediatrician is probably more as important, if not more important, than interviewing an obstetrician. What should someone be looking for when they look for a pediatrician?
Well, compatibility is the first thing that I think that parents need to, that a parent needs to look for. You need to look for the doctor's credentials. One of the questions is the length of time the doctor's been in practice. And I always ask the parent, I think the parents need to know if they feel that the doctor respects them, you know, and does he or she talk in a way, to them, that they can understand. The other thing is who covers him or her. I'm going to use him since it's, you know, I'm him. Who covers a doctor when he's unavailable? Who are you going to see? Each time you come into the office, will you see the doctor, the nurse practitioner, or a combination of such? And the big question is, can the doctor relate to me?
Yeah, I think that's kind of the central key. I mean, you got to get a feeling that this is an issue. This is a relationship that's going to last, because it really is more like a marriage with a pediatrician than it is more like a doctor visit. You're going to see the child many, many times when they're not sick. It's important, I think, many times to get phone calls back in a timely fashion, to be able to know who's giving you advice and when. As you said, to know some of the things about how the offices run. Location is always important.
Exactly.
We're always pleading with people to make selections about primary care people before they need them, because I think that's a more active part of the process.
Absolutely.
A couple things. Let me just give you, Dr. Carl Robinson, I guess he's a pediatrician. If you want to join us, you've got questions about your children, your grandchildren, your nieces and nephews. You've got questions about issues that you've read about or talked about with children. I don't know of a better resource than Dr. Carl Robinson, so give us a call, 510-848-4425, 510-848-4425, or 1-800-908-5008. Dr. Robinson, we call this not the cheapest second opinion in town, but the least expensive. A couple of things. Why do you think our children are so fat?
We this is a nurturing society, and everybody loves to feed these children. And it's it has become a severe problem, especially in the African American community, where traditionally people have just fed and fed and fed, and they start feeding at early times. I've had parents who come in at 2 and 3 weeks of age that the young women have said that grandmother told them to start feeding the baby.
And you know, it's funny because when I first started in pediatrics, we were starting feeding at about 3 or 4 weeks, weren't
we? That's correct. That shows you how old you are. But
I gotta remember we were right there together.
But we've changed those rules, and we're feeding the babies at later dates. We're not allowing them to eat. We're trying to make sure that they get a little more nutritious type of feeding, and a lot of, you know, with the vegetables and the fruits and those sorts of things that the baby can, its digestive system can tolerate.
You mean this is after the breastfeeding period you're talking about?
And that's after the breastfeeding period.
Right.
That's the other thing that is not happening. In certain parts of the country, people are still breastfeeding very adequately. And in some parts of the country, everybody's gone to bottle.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a tragedy because obviously the old rule is breast is best. And it's always been the best. And it's unfortunate that more mothers are not doing it.
How long do you recommend breastfeeding?
Until the mother and the baby tire.
Mm-hmm.
And that may be 4 to 6 months. Some people go as long as a year.
Yeah, okay. Well, that sounds like, but you still haven't answered the question. I mean, why do you know, clearly we like to feed children, but everybody knows by now that obesity in children is a major problem. Why do you think we're not more conscious of that? I mean, do you think that the society supports that? I mean, we talk about it all the time. Surgeon General talks about it, but, 99% of the time we're bombarded with these, fast food advertisings, and I don't think it's their fault. I think they're in job to do business. What I tell parents is a 5-year-old cannot drive down to McDonald's. You know, you've got to have somebody take you down there. And don't you think much of this has to do with how the parents perceive what their job is in terms of nutrition?
Oh, absolutely. I think that's the problem with the society is that fast foods are available and easy to get, and they don't require cooking, they don't require thought. And it's one of the problems with these busy parents. And what we have to train them to do is to prepare beforehand to care for these babies. Some of these parents are busy. Some of them are just plain lazy. But what has to happen is that the pediatrician has to take the time to re-emphasize proper nutrition for these children.
All right, let's start. 848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code, 1-800-908-5008. I got a lot of questions for Dr. Robinson, but I can get mine later. It's time for you to get yours. Let's go to Jacinto in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Thank you, Dr. Lenore. My question is, for a new parent of a 6-month-old child, what do you see are the necessary vaccinations the bare minimum? Because I'm worried about all the other stuff that's inside these vaccines.
Well, most of the information that, because of this concern that you express, a lot of research has been done on basic immunizations. And in fact, if I recall, the whooping cough portion of the DTP was reconstituted into an acellular format. But right now, we're recommending the DTAP, having it 3 times by the time a baby is 6 months. 6 months, he should be getting his third DTAP. He should be getting his third polio. He should be getting his hepatitis, his second probably his second hepatitis vaccine should have been done by then. And he should have his Haemophilus influenza vaccine at that time. A lot of these shots and immunizations are combined and have been studied in large numbers on, you know, great large volumes of children and appear not to have any, appear not to be as problematic as once thought. The problem comes to the child who doesn't get the shots because he puts himself, the parents put that particular child at risk because most of these children are in daycare or and not at home or they're in some other environment where they can be exposed to these illnesses.
Yeah, you know, the other thing is that the limiting factor is really not the pediatrician. I mean, we have for many years been more than willing to talk to parents about immunizations, to have them read the information, and then make their own choices. I mean, I have patients who want to get one shot here and one shot there and have designed their own program for immunizing children. And, you know, while I've looked, the data that impresses me is what I know clinically, is that we don't see as much meningitis, ear infections, mumps, varicella. We don't see as much hepatitis in these children that are vaccinated. But the limiting factor in this area, I don't know about New Orleans, becomes the school. Becomes preschool, becomes school, becomes anything you institution where you try to get your children into without the immunizations there. There was a time when we could write a note or do something like that, and it was permitted. But nowadays, I think what you bump up against a relatively inflexible institutional approach to immunizations. Now, you always talk about a couple things. We always talk about risk versus benefit. Clearly, immunizations are not without risk. I mean, and there are some risks that have been attributed to immunizations that have not proven out in large numbers to be credible. But there have been some immunizations that have been withdrawn.
Right.
So it's really risk versus benefit. The other thing that we also talk about is something called herd immunity. That means if your child's not immunized, then you carry into the society some of the potential infections that can be prevented by immunizations. However, I do have many parents who want to do it their own way, and I'm certainly more than willing to do that. But where you have troubles with daycare and schools and any institution where you want to put your child, unless you keep them at home for the full period of time, then that's where the society's become much less flexible as it relates to immunizations.
That's correct.
All right, any other questions? All right, let's go to Jeanette in San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Hi.
Hi.
I remember hearing that there was a lot of mold in New Orleans and all over the South because of the receding floodwaters and all the poison that was in it and also just normal, you know, environmental mold. And I know that mold is a problem here in California, especially in San Francisco, in a lot of older buildings. And I feel that, you know, it's impacted a lot of families, including my own. But could you reflect on what you've observed about that, how it's affected the lives of children and young people and just displaced people in New Orleans, and also the risk that they're claiming is there? They are using the risk of deadly mold to shut people out of their homes a lot of the time, and it's very political, and it's the kind of people that they just don't want to have come back, so they don't even turn the electric on or clean the place up. So,
yeah, there have been problems. You're right that the mold is in existence here. The problem is that most homes now, people are working in those homes. Actually, they sent professionals in to clear all the mold sites out. But in the low income housing, very little has been done with it in terms of the federal government has decided that they're going to tear down most of the housing projects because they are at greater risk there. And they've been emptied and they were full of water and that sort of thing. And they really need to change that whole process anyway. And so that's it's probably going to be an improvement in the overall situation. But in terms of really seeing an influx of problems related to molds. We really have not seen. I've talked to the allergists here, and they don't claim to see as much as we thought we would see.
You correct me if I'm wrong, because the mold in New Orleans is different from the mold that we encounter here.
Yes.
Most of the mold we encounter here is environmental mold. Most of the mold that they count here, they encounter in New Orleans, some of it is environmental, but there's something called rose fever in New Orleans. And what used to happen was when the roses used to bloom, then a lot of people got sick and they thought it was the roses. But really, most of the mold comes from what we call Basidium mycetes that grow on much of the vegetation in the area. And so then you get mold spores in the air as much as you do in environmental areas, and I think that's the difference.
And that's the difference.
So when you don't have as much vegetation as you don't have now that, you know, so much has been devastated, then you're less likely to have mold this year. You may be much more likely to have mold next year when things kind of get back to order. And I think that may be a reason why you don't have as much mold.
Yeah, we're looking forward to next year.
That's when you get all the black rashes you can't explain. All right, 848-4425 is our number in the 510 area code. We're talking to Dr. Carl Robinson, who's a very distinguished pediatrician in New Orleans, Louisiana. Our number, the toll-free number, 1-800-908-5008. Good chance to ask questions about your children, your grandchildren, your nieces, nephews, even yourself if you're old enough to qualify in that area. Let's go to Fred in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hey, hello.
How you doing, Fred?
I'm impressed by all this about mold, and I think about the family farm, the farmers markets around Oakland and in Berkeley. I do see a lot of lower income people down there. I think that's a real great way to fight fat. But, you know, in a lot of the traditional recipes, you know, greens and whatnot are really good for you, beans and greens and all. Anyway, what I called about is my next-door neighbor, who's a real good friend of mine, just had a baby, and I hear on a radio, on a show on KPFA tomorrow, it's in the same time slot, I think. She talks a lot about...
Is your radio on...
I'll be quick. She talks a lot about GMO food and how GMO the stuff sneaks in and how there's stuff down where the baby crawls, you know, that you don't smell because you're upstairs, but if there's crap in the rug, you know, stuff that's going to mess with the baby genetically, they're real sensitive, and I just was concerned about the little tyke. So I thought I'd ask you what you think about that, preventing various substances, bad guys, from getting in the baby.
If I'm crawling around on the floor and... Right. You got a theory on that?
Genetically modified
foods.
Foods, yeah.
I got you, okay. Okay, what do you think about genetically modified foods, Dr. Robinson?
I really have very little opinion on that at this point. I don't have enough experience with and time in looking at that problem at this point.
Lena Berman, I think is her name.
I think she has far more experience than we have with genetic modified foods. And so consequently, I think she'll be on tomorrow. Maybe you could call and ask about that, and she probably has a much broader experience than we have with that. We don't see much of that in this area, at least not that I'm aware of. I think your first point is, let me say it differently. I'm not aware of much of it, but that doesn't, I'm not the expert.
Right.
But I do think that the farmers markets and the and people getting fresh vegetables and fruits are increasing in number, and we're really happy to see that. All right, let's see. Craig in Mid Pines, you're in About Health.
Hi. You still there?
Yeah, sure.
I heard a loud sound. I mainly want to talk about breastfeeding. If you don't mind, I just have a really quick comment, or maybe it's a question about something you said in passing. I hope it was in jest, but it was something about how after the obstetrician slaps the baby, he leaves and he's no longer in your life. I just hope it's not the case that obstetricians are still slapping babies after they're born.
No, that was just kind of a concept.
I know, it's kind of
my little weak attempt at, you know, Alan.
Yeah.
He's
not a good comedian.
All right, guys. Okay.
Okay, I was just checking, because I know that used to be, of course, the practice, and I'm hoping in this day and age that that's no longer a standard practice in the delivery room.
It is no longer standard.
Okay, that's good. There's much better ways to get the newborns to start breathing. About breastfeeding, now let's see, in your discussion, you were using the figure of 4 to 6 months is good and up to a year is okay. Now, I would say really 6 months is bare minimum if you're going to do it. A year would be quite, you know, kind of a standard length of time, so to speak. Hopefully at that point, most babies are learning to walk about then, and a lot of them, that's about the right time to wean them. They accept it much more, you know, with less distress. And I was just talking to my wife about this just a couple of days ago. She teaches human development classes at a community college, and it had come to her attention that one of her former students had gotten pregnant unexpectedly, had a baby, and she wasn't a single mom at the time, but she ended up being a single mom by the time the baby was born, which means she's we call it TANF now. It used to be called just welfare. And here's the thing. To my shock and horror, now, they used to give the young mothers who are getting this assistance 6 months. Now they are giving you 6 weeks, and at that point you go back to work or you start going out and looking for work, and the baby has to go into daycare at 6 weeks. So I find this horrendous, not just in the fact that it makes it impossible to actually successfully nurse. You might do it for 6 weeks, and that's I suppose anything's better than nothing, but this is just a shocking thing to me. I want to know if either of you as doctors are aware of this.
We're critically aware of it. I mean, first of all, to respond to what Dr. Robinson said about breastfeeding, not to put words in his mouth, but usually it's the mother and the baby together who determine how long the breastfeeding goes on. And we have mothers breastfeeding up to 2 years of age who are comfortable with that. And we have some who stop at a month of age. And I think that it really becomes an individual choice. I think successful breastfeeding can go on for a very long period of time. I think the American Academy recommends you can exclusively breastfeed up to a year of age, and then they recommend additional support.
Right.
As it relates to, it's no particular sector. I mean, many jobs don't pay for, don't pay any benefits while you're, after you deliver, and some people give you time off to deal with the baby, but not much. And so this is a country that talks a lot about the importance of breastfeeding and the importance of nurturing infants. But when you start talking about corporations and people that determine or define how long you're able to do that, I think you're going to find a whole different philosophy as it relates to the workplace. Dr. Robinson, what's your experience?
Yeah, that's been my experience also, that that it depends upon the company that the woman works for, and it depends upon, most people will give them 2 or 3 months. It really depends on who you work for. If you get a benevolent employer, you may get more time off to do just that, to breastfeed, to do all the nurturing things that need to happen. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could all do that, have all our mothers off, or even the mothers and the fathers off for that period of time to take care of the babies? But since it's not possible, some employers have been very good about that.
All right, thank you very much for that question and comment. Very good, Craig. Let's go to Laurie in Mid-City. You're on About Health.
Yes, hi. I'm calling to ask if there's a correlation between immunization shots for children and eczema, because my child, who was immunized when she was 2 months, soon after developed a rash on her leg, and it became eczema, and so I don't know if... The doctor said there wasn't a correlation, but, you know, being a mother and knowing my child, you know, to me it was a direct correlation. So I just want to know from your point of view.
Well, let me just respond by saying I know of no correlation either, but I'm going to defer this comment to Dr. Lenore, who is an allergist.
Well, I think the first thing to say is that when you observe, when mothers observe something that happens to babies after incidents, I tend to believe mothers. You know, I think that there's really very little correlation, actual correlation, between the development of eczema of immunization, except for a couple instances. We know that children who are egg sensitive don't handle a couple of vaccines that have egg associated with them. They handle the MMR well, which is the measles, mumps, and rubella, given at age 15 months ordinarily. But they don't handle influenza vaccines very well. So that what kind of vaccination? What age did you get the vaccination?
2 months.
Oh yeah. It's not associated with diphtheria, pertussis, or tetanus. But your child's an individual. You were there with that child. You've made this observation, and I would not discount it just based upon the fact that you are there. Mm-hmm. And in most instances of eczema, parents do know as much about it as we can figure out from the tests and things that we do. So I do think that that it is important, A, to make sure it's eczema and not seborrhea,
mm-hmm.
because sometimes if you listen, baby, have any cradle cap at all?
No.
Okay, if it is eczema, then usually it's not associated, but believe me, I believe parents when they make these kinds of associations. All right.
Thank you.
All right, thank you for calling us. Let me give the number again, 848-4425, the 510 area code, and 1-800-958-5008, 1-800-958-9008. All right, let's go to Fairfax and talk to Pat. You're on About Health.
Hello, gentlemen.
Hello, Pat.
I've got a story for you about a very famous pediatrician. Do you remember Dr. Spock?
Of course.
Dr. Benjamin Spock?
Of course.
He was being interviewed in his late 90s on early morning TV.
Uh-huh.
And he was asked, is there anything about your life, anything you regret? And he said, yes. Here's what he said. He said, I wish I had known 60 years ago, the great harm that is done to children's health by dairy food. Dairy food. And I have students, a lot of people were calling me, oh, you know what Dr. Spock said, blah, blah, blah. You think one word of that was on later in the day? Not a word.
No.
So I just wanted to tell you that.
Yeah, we have a saying in pediatrics that everybody does not need milk. There are other ways to get calcium and some of the nutrients that children get, and a lot of children can't handle milk either because they're intolerant or they're allergic to it. And so consequently, I think we have to be very, very careful when we start to recommend nourishment for every child the exact same thing. I think breast milk, clearly, superior to anything else we can give an infant. However, after that age, then I think everybody does not need milk. Many people don't benefit from it, and there can be a number of problems that develop as a result of that. So I think each child is very individual, and I think the planning a diet based upon what's good in terms of protein, carbohydrates, and nutrition, and fats, and integrating that diet into an infant successfully, keeping in mind the number of calories and the role that fast foods and non-organic foods play in the whole process, I think is a very, very big job, but I think it's a job that every parent should take on. Dr. Robinson, one final word on the New Orleans situation. Where are you going in New Orleans?
I'm sorry?
One final word about where you think New Orleans is headed?
Well, we can only go up. There's no place else to go. If they do it properly, if it's done properly, and health and medical care, I should say, are taken care of appropriately, I think we'll be fine.
Dr. Carl Robinson has been our guest from New Orleans. We want to thank him very much for taking his valuable time to join us. A lot of good questions. Want to thank you for joining us. Want to thank Ranjita Geisler for coming back to assist us on the board, she and her infant. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
Sandino, a 4-day film festival about Nicaragua for historic memory and a better world at La Peña in Berkeley. They say the revolution will not be televised, but it already has. 27 years ago in Nicaragua, the Sandinista revolution triumphed with a 10-year burst of creative energy to build a new society. The process inspired filmmakers globally, making the Nicaraguan revolution the first and most scrutinized revolution in history. Viva Sandino Film Festival, July 18th to 21st at La Peña in Berkeley, a benefit for lapeña.org.
KPFA's Summer Mini Fun Drive begins Monday, July 24th. Members of your community group, labor union, or nonprofit organization will be thanked on the air every day they come in to answer phones. To sign up as a phone volunteer for KPFA's Summer Fun Drive, please call 510-848-6767, extension 618. You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, or online at KPFA.